Hello and welcome to another episode in the Godot Basics Tutorial Series. In this episode, we will be taking a look at the animation resource. Now, the animation resource is a resource used to animate everything in the game engine. You can think of it as a data container used for animation purposes for the Godot application. Now, what's really cool about Godot is that you are free to do pretty much anything in terms of creativity, and one of those things could possibly be if you wanted to create your own trailer, just because of what the animation resource provides you. Now, the animation class inherits from the resource class, which again inherits from the reference class, which means we don't have to worry about managing its memory. On top of that, the animation resource must be used with a node that can take advantage of its capabilities. For example, the animation player node, which is a node object, or a node that can be attached onto the scene tree. Now, the animation resource class provides you with three properties: length, loop, and step. Now, length is just the total length of your animation, and by default, it's set to the float value 1.0, which just means 1 second. The loop property is set to false by default, and that basically means that you either want to or you do not want your animation to loop. So by default, animation looping is set to false. You just want the animation to run one time. And lastly is the step property, which by default is set to the float value 0.1, and that just means the animation step value. The animation resource class comes with a signal. It's called tracked change, and it's emitted when there's a change in the list of tracks, so when either a track is added, moved, or has changed its path. Now, in this episode, we won't go over signals, but it's here just to let you know that the animation resource class does come with a signal. Now, the most important thing to understand about the animation resource class is the track type enum. And it's important to understand track types because you need to supply the correct track type depending on the methods you want to use provided to you by the animation resource class. And again, different animation tracks have different types, each with its own set of dedicated methods. Now, track type is basically just enums, and in Godot, the animation resource class provides you with 6 different track types. Those would be the type value, type transform, type method, type bezier, type audio, and type animation. The one you're most likely going to be using in your day-to-day will be type value, and that's because when you want to interpolate node properties, you're going to use the track type, type value, enum. And of course, the second most important type you may end up using is type audio, and it handles audio streams. Regardless of what track type enum you're going to use, you basically have to follow this basic formula for creating an animation resource. First, obviously, you have to declare your animation resource, but after that, you need to set up the length of your animation, and this is very important. By default, it's set to 1 second. However, you may not want to have your animation last for a second. You may want to have it last for more than a second. So in a sense, you need to change that. After that, you need to add your tracks, basically by defining its track type. Then, depending on the track, you need to call the appropriate set method. And that's an important word to understand. You need to set it. And then lastly, after you've set your track, depending on the track, you need to call its appropriate insert key method. And then from there, you're allowed to insert as many as you want, as long as it's within the length you've set for your animation. And we will go ahead and take a look at this in code at the end of the episode. So the first thing you need to do is add a track. And so you use the add track method. You declare your track type, and then you can define its position. But by default, it's -1, which again means you're going to add it towards the end of your array, because -1 is the last index position of your array. And the add track method returns back an integer value, which is just the index position it has been set in the array. After adding a track, you're going to set, or use the appropriate set method. And in this case, we're going to use track set path, assuming we're using the enum track type called value. And basically, you're going to provide its track index, followed by the node path. And again, because we're using the value enum type, or excuse me, the type value enum. That means we want to interpolate between node properties. And so in this case, we need to provide a node path, which is a string value to your property set on the node. So for example, the position property. Now, after you've used the appropriate set method, you need to insert a key. So in this case, again, because we're using the track type value, we're going to use the track insert key method. And again, we need to provide the track type index followed by the position in time, which again is limited to our linked property, followed by a variant value, which just represents the key value. And then we can also add the appropriate transition type, which is set to 1 by default. And basically, we insert a generic key in a given track. Before I get into the coding example, let's go over some other methods provided to us that you may find useful. First, you have the clear method, which just deletes all tracks in your track array. You may not need to use it, but it's there. Next, you have the copy track method, and all you do is copy a track and you pass it into an animation type. Just keep in mind that it returns back a void, or excuse me, it has the return data type void, which just means that it doesn't return back anything. And that's because you're just copying a track, not necessarily returning back a value. Next, you have the find track method, and you need to provide it a node path, and it's just going to search your array for the appropriate node path. Keep in mind, you can only have one node path per track, but regardless, it's going to find it and return back an integer value, which is just its index position in the given array. And lastly, we do have a method called getTrackCount, which just returns back the total amount of tracks you have in your array. Let's go ahead and take a look at a code example. Now, I'm going to go ahead and upload this to GitHub, so please feel free to go ahead and download that and play around with it. If you press the play button, you're going to see an animation set by your animation resource. In the next episode, we'll go over the animation player, but in this episode, I just want to stick to the animation resource class. So as you can see here in our animation class, we are extending from the animation resource class. And of course, we've given a class name, and this is just for preparation for the next episode. And everything is inside a function called getAnimationResource method, which returns back an animation data type. And of course, the self keyword represents our animation class. And because we're extending from the animation class, by returning back using the self keyword, we are in fact returning back an animation data type. So let's go ahead and take a look at this real quick. So in this case, we followed step one, define our length. In this case, we're going to have an animation that lasts 2 seconds long. We can ignore the print statements. That's just for you if you decide to download it from GitHub so you can see the values and how it changes over time. After that, we need to add a track. In this case, we're going to use the type value as the track type, which is just the value of 0, which is just basically we want to interpolate between a node property. And we're going to assign that integer value, which is the index position, which in this case will be 0. And we're going to assign that value into our variable called track index. After that, we are going to use the track set path method. We're going to provide it the index value, which in this case is 0. And then we're going to provide it a node path, which is just a string value of the property value we would like to interpolate. So in this case, we would like to access the root scene tree, followed by the top level parent node. In this case, that value, or excuse me, the node name is node2d. And we would like to interpolate the node called enemy. We would like to interpolate not only the position value, but more specifically, the x value of the position value, which just means we would like to affect the x-axis of our node. And from there, we can in fact insert keys for this specific track index, because by using the track set path method, we've defined that our track index will be related to the enemy node's position x value. So in this case, we insert a key at the 0 second position for our track index, and we would like the x value to be at the position of 0. After that, we would like to insert another key on the track index variable, which again is 0, which in turn means we're just talking about the enemy node's position x property value. And at the 1 second, we would like that x position value to be 100. So keep in mind that the computer is going to calculate at the 0 second we would like to be at position 0, and we will do internal calculations to make sure that the node moves. And by the first second, we will be at the position x value of 100. And now, as you can see here, we're going to add another key, because keep in mind our length is 2 seconds, so we can manipulate as many keys as we want as long as we're under the 2 second length value. And in this case, we would like to do the same thing, track index. And in this case, at the second second, we would like our position x value for the enemy node object to be at the position value of 500. And so in our heads, we can just imagine what's happening. At the 0 second, we're going to move very, very slowly until our x position is at 100 at the first second. And then at the second second, because we're going to move 400 pixels to the right, you can imagine in your head that our node object called enemy is going to sort of snap. And lastly, I have some extra methods so you can play around with. In this case, we have find track, and then you can see the values being printed out onto the screen. Then we're going to add another track that's completely different than our first track, and we're going to assign it to a different variable. We're going to set the path, but we're not going to add any keys to it. And then we're going to again find that track based on the node path, and we're going to print those to the screen so you can see the values changing over time, so you can get a better understanding, or in this case, a higher level understanding of the animation resource class. There's a lot that goes on in the animation resource class, but in this episode, I just want to break it down into the necessities. So to summarize, we need to set a length or change the length property value if we want to work with anything more than 1 second. After setting the length property to whatever you want it to be, we need to add a track, and then after that, set a path. And then after that, we can insert as many keys as we want as long as it's within the length property value. So in this case, if we press play, you can see we move slow, and then we sort of snap, and this took 2 seconds. Now let me show you what happens if we add keys that go beyond the length value we set. So in this case, I'm going to change the value to 1. We're going to go ahead and play that. And notice here at 1 second, we don't do the second track, or in this case, the second key, which would make our enemy position object x's value at the position 500, because in this case, our set length is only 1 second long, and regardless of what we inserted, even though we declared that at the second second we would like to be at the value 500 for our position x value, we're just going to stop here at the first second, and that's because the amount of length, or excuse me, the amount of seconds allowed for your animation to run was set here to 1 second, and that's basically it for this episode. Well, that's all I have for you in this episode. Thank you so much for joining me. Thank you for clicking the like button, and thank you for clicking the subscribe button. Don't forget to download the GitHub project and play around with the code and see what happens when you change certain properties or use certain methods. If you have any questions or comments, please feel free to leave them in the comments section down below. I look forward to seeing you in the next episode. Have an amazing day.